Welcome to worship on this Sunday, and welcome to our family vacation in North Carolina. We are currently standing at Pulpit Rock here in North Carolina and just enjoying all the wonderful creation that God has made here. So let's give Him praise today on this Sunday morning.
Thank you.
I want to thank the congregation for allowing Anna and the kids and I to have a few days of just rest and reflection. We are up here in North Carolina and found out that the place where we're staying is actually part of a Lutheran camp and conference area, Luther Ridge. And so being able to be here has just given me pause to reflect and to thank God for the many blessings in life, but also to spend some time and thank Him for the forgiveness that He gives us. Confession is a place where we find peace, peace that we can't find anywhere else. And it's because of the cross and because of what Jesus has done for us where we can confess our sin and find freedom and hope and healing. So let's do that today. Let's confess our sin. Let's examine our life through the lens of Scripture and come before Him and praise His holy name. So let's pray. Heavenly Father, thank You. Thank You for the rest we have in Christ. Thank You that there's nothing we can do that's going to cause You to love us more. And there's nothing we can do that's going to cause You to love us less. And so we come before You without fear then, because of what Jesus accomplished on the cross. And we thank You for the hope we have in Christ. We confess to You that we've not been all that we could be in Christ Jesus this week. We've not loved You with all of our heart, mind, soul, and strength, and we've not loved our neighbor as ourselves. And so we ask for You to forgive us. We confess to You our need daily for the power of the gospel in our lives through Jesus. And we thank You for Your deep, deep love for us. And so help us this week through the power of Your Holy Spirit, through the teaching of Your word, to be more and more like Jesus. Thank You. Thank You for the peace You give us and the hope we have that our sins are forgiven and that we can live for You unto Your glory. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Be comforted and assured, my brothers and sisters, that our God loves us very much and that Jesus came and died on the cross to forgive us for our sins. And so live in that freedom and know that God loves you very, very, very much. And so do I.
Who shall ascend the hill of the Lord? And who shall stand in his holy place? He who has clean hands and a pure heart, who does not lift up his soul to what is false and does not swear deceitfully, he will receive blessing from the Lord and righteousness from the God of his salvation. Sure is the generation of those who seek him, who seek the face of the God of Jacob.
as we start our time in the Word, I want to just invite you into a place of peace as we talk about a subject that is pretty divisive in our world today, the subject of marriage and how the Bible talks about that. We're going to talk about this over this week and next week. I'm going to break this up in a couple of Sundays. Because the topic of marriage is so important, and it's not one of those things that God just sort of stumbled on and say, hey, let's try this. I really believe that God had a plan for what marriage was going to stand for and how our relationships in our marriages have a very holy purpose. You know, I'm sitting here at a picnic table here at this camp Lutheridge, and I remember many years ago attending a camp in Lake Wales, Florida, and hearing camp counselors talk to us about relationships and how God had special plans for His people in relationships. And as my family is just over on this other side of the ridge, we're planning on capping out our vacation here tonight. Just thinking about how blessed I am as a man, as a husband, as a pastor, the many blessings that are in my life. But just wanting to spend a few moments with you sharing some thoughts, because we're going to be talking more specifically about wives in this sermon today. But I want us to talk about it from the standpoint of how we can bring glory to God and how we can be a blessing to others, and that God has a plan for us in marriage. And so as we read these passages, as we talk about the concepts that are in these, I want us to do so with a humble heart, understanding that oftentimes our culture speaks to us a lot louder than the scriptures. And let's just humble ourselves and let the Word of God speak to us. So let me pray. Let me read some scripture, talk about it a little bit, and I hope that we are all blessed as a result of this. So Heavenly Father, help us now as we study Your Word, as we continue this study in the book of Ephesians. Help us to understand what Paul is saying to us regarding the sacredness, the holiness of marriage, and the purpose of marriage. And so we humble ourselves and ask that, Holy Spirit, You would help us to understand this and apply these words to our lives, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Ephesians chapter 5. I'm going to read the entire text of what we're going to be talking about over the next couple of weeks. We're only going to be talking about the first few verses tonight, but I want to pull an idea in from the very end of this text, and then apply it to what we're going to be talking about regarding what God's desire is for wives in marriage. And then we're going to apply the same things next week as we talked to the guys, to the husbands. Ephesians chapter 5, verses 21 through 33. Brothers and sisters, this is the word of the Lord. Submit to one another out of reverence for Christ. Wives, submit to your own husbands as to the Lord, for the husband is the head of the wife, even as Christ is the head of the church, his body, and is himself its Savior. Now as the church submits to Christ, so also wives should submit in everything to their husbands. Husbands, love your wives, as Christ loved the church and gave himself up for her, that he might sanctify her, having cleansed her by the washing of water with the word, so that he might present the church to himself in splendor, without spot or wrinkle or any such thing, that she might be holy and without blemish. In the same way, husbands should love their wives as their own bodies. He who loves his wife loves himself, for no one ever hated his own flesh, but nourishes and cherishes it just as Christ does the church, because we are members of his body. Therefore, a man shall leave his father and mother and hold fast to his wife, and the two shall become one flesh. This mystery is profound, and I'm saying that it refers to Christ and the church. However, let each one of you love his wife as himself, and let the wife see that she respects her husband. Brothers and sisters, this is the word of the Lord. Now, as we think this through this text, sorry, I've got a mosquito there on my hand. I needed to shoo away. There's some deep things going on here,
And I pray that as we read Scripture, we will always come at Scripture with a humble heart and willing to submit to God the Father and submit to Christ our Savior. And as we've been instructed, and as we talked about last week, that we are to submit to one another. It's that concept that is so important for us. Now let's remember, these are words that are spoken to God's covenant family. We are the ones who said, yes, we believe in Jesus, and we stand by faith on what Christ has done through his sacrifice on the cross. His death on the cross means so much to us. And so by coming to him in faith and submitting ourselves to him, we're also saying that we want to follow the commandments, and we want to follow the instruction that we've been given. And so when we remind ourselves on a weekly basis that we are to love the Lord our God with all of our heart, mind, soul, and strength, that we are to love our neighbor as ourselves, those seem pretty self-evident. But have you ever thought about the context of marriage within those two commandments? That even in our marriages, we are to seek to bring glory to God first and foremost. And we're supposed to seek to be a blessing to one another. I knew a couple when I was a youth pastor in Philadelphia who every day tried to out-love the other. And they would look for ways to share love, to speak love, to be someone who would out-love the other. And I don't know I'm sure there were some days that one did better than the other, but it was a marriage that really displayed a heartfelt desire to submit to one another and love one another. So as we talk about this text, we see that Paul's got some deeper thoughts in mind regarding marriage than typically what we come at that subject with. You can go to many bookstores, you can go online and type in, self-help for marriage or marriage advice or, a number of those different kinds of books, and you'll find many from a Christian standpoint. In fact, in my office at the church, I've got a whole shelf full of marriage books that are helpful for specific things. But as we come to this text gets really to the root of what we need to be thinking through when it comes to marriage. Now, I am speaking specifically to the husbands and wives. And those who are watching and those who are attending on campus today, there are a number who are married to husbands and wives that are attending and will be listening to this. There, we have a number of our folks that one of the spouses will be attending and the other is not as active in church or maybe not even a believer. I believe all of these things apply. But I invite any who are single, who are not married, to listen in on this as well. Because I believe what Paul is saying here is a testimony that our lives as husbands and wives testify to the people in this world of God's intention for his people. And it is a living illustration of God's love for us. At the very end of this text, Paul refers to a mystery. Therefore, a man shall leave his father and mother and hold fast to his wife, and the two shall become one flesh. I'm sorry, I'm getting another mosquito off of me. And then he says, this mystery is profound. Now let's remind ourselves that when Paul uses that word mystery, he's not talking about something where the information is unknown, that it can't be discovered. He's talking about something that has been revealed through the Holy Spirit, revealed in God's good time, revealed about his redemption plan. And we have said many times at our church that all Scripture points to Jesus. And so as we take a look at this passage and the passage that it's linked to, we see that Scripture really is pointing us to Jesus and what Christ has done for the church. So let me go and reread that passage from Genesis chapter 2 that gives us the account of creation from the Genesis 2 point of view. Starting in verse 18 and reading through verse 25, we read these words. Then the Lord God said, "It is not good that the man should be alone. I will make him a helper fit for him. Now out of the ground the Lord God had formed every beast of the field and every bird of the heavens and brought them to the man to see what he would call them. And whatever the man called every living creature, that was its name. The man gave names to all the livestock and to all the birds of the heavens and to every beast of the field. But for Adam there was not found a helper fit for him. So the Lord God caused a deep sleep to fall upon the man. And while he slept, took one of his ribs and closed up its place with flesh. And the rib that the Lord God had taken from the man, he made into a woman and brought her to the man. Then the man said, "This at last is bone of my bones and flesh of my flesh. She shall be called woman because she was taken out of man. Therefore a man shall leave his father and mother and hold fast to his wife, and they shall become one flesh." And the man and his wife were both naked and were not ashamed. And so as we see in this initial story of creation, it's not good for us to be alone. Even those of you who are watching this and engaging in this text who are single, you know it's not good to be alone. Many of you have, you know, spend many hours, you know, visiting with friends and in conversation. We as people are just not wired to be alone. Even those of you who are the most introverted introverts still at times like to be around people. Well, there is this longing for belonging in the hearts of people. And at the core of that, many find that real longing to connect in a very deep covenantal way. And that's marriage. All the way back in Genesis 2, we start seeing God's deep plan to reveal his love for us. Now, by the time we get to Ephesians chapter 5, we all know the man and the woman, they sinned in the garden. There has been this attempt to try to deal with sin. We in our own pride, try to solve our own problems. God rescued. He called Abraham to be his covenant son. And then through Abraham, we have the nation of Israel. We see all of these stories through the Old Testament of people trying to do everything they can through obeying the covenant, the commandments to make things right. But it was never, ever sufficient. That's why we needed Christ. And as Christ died on the cross, he formed the new covenant. But have you ever stopped to think about what led Christ to come? I think this is where we begin to see the deeper meaning behind marriage. Philippians chapter 2 tells us how Christ did not consider the glories of heaven something to be grasped, but he emptied himself and humbled himself and came to this earth. And the Gospel of John tells us he came to do the will of the Father. He submitted to the Father in order to bring about the redemption that God so longed for. See, when God created men and women, he created us to live in relationship with him. He created us to live in covenant. And sin broke that covenant. But that didn't mean that God stopped desiring to live in covenant with his people. And so through Christ, we have this picture of self-sacrificial love, sacrificing everything because of love to reconnect God's people to the Father. So coming back to the text here, we see that husbands and wives play a role in demonstrating to the world what that love looks like. Now, let me just pause real quick, because I know that there are many who, when I read that Ephesians text, maybe your blood pressure started going up a little bit, or maybe you started gritting your teeth a little bit, because some of the words there are words that maybe some of you thought, hey, this is the 21st century. Haven't we gotten beyond some of this? Haven't we been enlightened to know that one sex, one gender is not better than the other? I hope we can hear a screeching record or maybe some screeching breaks here. Let's just slow down a little bit, because this text is not about saying one gender is better than the other. And this text is not about saying husbands are better than wives. No, this text is calling both wives and husbands to a very important attitude when it comes to our relationships. So yes, he does say that for wives, that they are to submit to their own husbands as to the Lord. And we saw last week that we all, every one of us, whether we're married or not, are to submit to one another. That as brothers and sisters in Christ, our attitude is to live in submission to one another out of love, that we are to put others' needs before ourselves. And so we've already looked at that's a general description of what a spirit-filled person looks like. We are to be submissive to one another. And then that's right from that flows this other description that we are to that wives should be submissive to their husbands as to the Lord. All right, are you still with me? Please don't turn the computer or the TV off just yet. Because just to give a sneak peek, next week, guys, we're talking, you know, when we talk about this, there's going to be some huge things that we have to hear as well. You know, both husbands and wives need to be submissive. When a wife is being submissive, it's not because she's any less. It's not because she's less intelligent, any of those things. I mean, I'll be the first to admit, my wife is far smarter than me in many different areas. In fact, I don't know where I'd be, you know, in terms of my life without the impact and the influence and the partnership I have with Anna. She is such an important part of my life. And yet, as we take a look at this passage, we see that marriage is far more than just finding someone to help me self-actualize, finding someone that will meet all of my different needs and help me be the best me that I can be. That's not what marriage is supposed to be about. It's not supposed to be about finding this perfect person that is going to make me the best me, and doesn't really matter what happens with her. No, marriage is about us mutually wanting to live sacrificially and submissively with one another in order to help each one of us glorify God and be a blessing to others. And let's face it, all of us who are married, it's not always the easiest thing in the world. It probably wasn't always easy for Jesus to come to this earth and to live here and to gather his disciples and to teach them and to train them and then to die for them. I hope you can see where this is going. In marriage, we put the other person first. And our acts of submission, our acts of love, are not intended to lessen us. It's not intended, and never ever in the scriptures do we see where God looks at women and says, you are the inferior gender. Never, ever. In fact, Jesus did so much to elevate women. Jesus did so much to level the playing field when it comes to women being involved in the life of the church. But when it comes to marriage, we see here that Paul has a plan, and that plan is rooted in this plan that God had from the very beginning of what our marriages are supposed to portray to the world. And what our marriages are supposed to portray to the world was the deep, 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 deep love that God has for us. How that was demonstrated to us through Christ Jesus, and how we as the church demonstrate our love back. And so wives sort of take that aspect, that role of demonstrating the grateful heart of grace. By grace we have been saved. By grace God has given us our spouses. And so in this context, Paul says, submit to your husbands as to the Lord. And so in the context of marriage, that is part of what is being portrayed, is this submission to the Lord. Now, I know many have read the next line, for the husband is the head of the wife, even as Christ is the head of the church, and that's where oftentimes we begin to bristle. But headship is not about putting people down. I know that this has been a misused text for by many Christian men for many years to subjugate women, to silence them, and to make them feel in fear. That is not Paul's intention here in this text at all. His intention is to show that as wives lovingly submit to their husbands, and as we'll see next week, as husbands sacrificially love their wives, that there's a two-way grace going on here in relationships that in marriages that point to the graciousness and goodness of God, how he has given us new life in Christ, how he has covenanted with us, and how we gratefully live for our King and Savior and Lord. And so as we live in our relationships, as we live in our marriages, may we begin to see our marriages as a testimony to those around us. May we begin to see our marriages as an example of Christ's love for us. Christ didn't come in to domineer and to lord over and to be a brutal dictator. No. Christ came as a self-sacrificial king who went to the cross in order to die for our sins. And so when we see a husband and a wife who are living out the pattern that we see Paul talking about here in Ephesians 5, we see through the role that the wife has of being loving and submissive in a way that acknowledges a gratitude for grace. I'm not saying that wives don't have a say. Not saying that at all. In fact, aren't we called as the church to pray and to seek and to plead and to persevere? Hasn't God listened to our prayers and responded to our requests and petitions? Yes, many times. And so as we finish this up next week, I pray that we'll see that our marriage relationships are not about elevating one and pressing down another. It's about exalting a loving Father. It's about exalting a sacrificial Savior. It's about praising God for allowing us to be part of the body of Christ, to be part of the church. And so when wives and husbands live into those roles, it's like preaching a sermon. It's like proclaiming the gospel. It's like singing a praise song or hymn. It's declaring the goodness of God. So as we think about this text, as we consider it this next week, are there areas, wives, that maybe we're having a hard time submitting in? Maybe it's because of some of the actions of your husbands. Guys, let's begin the process of preparing ourselves. Some of us need to lead better in our homes. Some of us need to serve more in our homes. Are we nurturing our wives to the point where they can live in gratitude? This is an important thing, because so often in the church we allow culture to influence our walk more than what the scriptures do. So let's prayerfully read through this text multiple times this week. Let's prayerfully seek God's wisdom as we seek his will, and may we as Christian husbands and wives seek to demonstrate the grace of God. Now, for those of you who are in marriage that sometimes is labeled as unequally yoked, maybe your husband or maybe your wife is not active in faith. Maybe they've just outright or have rejected the faith. Let me encourage you to live in these roles as well, to graciously submit or to graciously sacrificially love, and to demonstrate the goodness of God. Does that mean that you go along with any sinful behavior? Absolutely not. Our first allegiance, our first submission is to Jesus, is to God the Father. And so we're not going to break the commandments. But are there things that we can do to demonstrate our love for our spouse in a way that shows the the graciousness and goodness of God. Let's think that through. And let's live unto the glory of God today and tomorrow and the next day. Let's let our marriages speak loudly of the grace of God. Those of you who are sensing that there's got to be more in life, and you're sensing that God is pulling on your heart right now, I want to give you an opportunity to respond. That pull is the Holy Spirit, and the Holy Spirit right now, I believe, is telling you that yes, Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life, that his death on the cross is the only thing that can save us from our sins, and that the Spirit poured out into us gives us hope to live empowered lives today. And so let me pray. And for those of you who are sensing, you know what, I've accepted Christ, but my life seems a little flat, I encourage you to pray that same gospel-empowered prayer, and just relying upon the power of Christ through the Holy Spirit in your life as well. And may we all seek to live out the testimony of God's grace in our lives through our marriages, or if we're not married, through
our loving interaction with people this week. So let's pray. Heavenly Father, we believe that Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life. We believe that his death on the cross is the only thing that can wash our sins away. And Father, we declare that Jesus is your Son, the Son of the living God, and we declare that he is our Savior and that he is our Lord. And so, Father, we pray for your power. Fill us with your Holy Spirit this week. May we be made complete as we seek to live in obedience. And Father, may our lives testify to others of your graciousness and goodness. May our marriages say that to others. May our relationships with others say that to others. And may our words declare the glory of God and the gospel of Jesus Christ. So bless my brothers and sisters. Bless them with hope. Bless them with healing. And bless them, Father, with a deeper sense of your love and your purpose for them, for their marriages, and for their families. I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Hey, thank you for joining us for worship, and thank you for putting up with my t-shirt and my wanderings and ramblings here in the woods of North Carolina. I just have loved walking around this camp and reminding myself of the many wonderful experiences that God has given me over the years in a place like this. In fact, I'm here at a campfire site, and I remember dedicating my life to Christian service, oh, many, many years ago at a place just like this. And so may your life this week be lived out to the dedication of God. And part of what we dedicate are our tithes and offerings. Thank you all so much for your generosity in giving to the church. If you feel led to give, go to our website, www.frctampa.org/give. That's our secure giving portal. Or you can mail a check to 8283 West Hillsborough Avenue, Tampa, Florida 33615. We have a new men's Bible study starting up. It's an online study starting up on Thursday. Guys have already started doing the homework for that, but if you'd like to jump in on that, give me a ring at the church or email me at dave@frctampa.org, and I'd love to send you the invite for that men's Bible study. There's also a women's Bible study starting up here soon, too, and so call the church office or email Donna Harold at deacons@frctampa.org, and she can get that information for you as well. Consistory, we have our meeting tomorrow night, and so don't forget about that as well, 6:30 p.m. Well, be blessed, everyone. I can't wait to see everyone when we get back to Florida. And for those of you who've been participating online, I just thank you so much for your continued support, your continued participation. May we all live to the glory of God, to the blessing of others. Love you. Can't wait to see you. Hopefully it's soon. Bye. By the way, one more thing. If you want to go deeper in this subject on Christian marriage, there are two books that I have found especially helpful. They are books that get to the deep theology of marriage. One is The Meaning of Marriage by Timothy Keller, and the other is This Momentary Marriage by John Piper. You can pick those up at Christian Book Distributors, Amazon.com, a number of different places. I have found these books extremely helpful because they talk about what the Word says about marriage by two respected Christian pastors and authors. And so consider picking one of these books. I think Tim Keller's book, The Meaning of Marriage, is probably the simpler and the quickest read. But this Momentary Marriage is deep and rich and wonderful if you want to go even deeper into this subject. So just want to have two book recommendations if you'd like to go a little bit deeper in this subject. All right. I love you again still, and can't wait to see you soon.